I need a fridge for my house, but being a bachelor, I hardly have much use for it except for the occasional storage of excess milk and some cold water. So I decided, why not build one by myself that suits my need exactly. In this episode, I'm going to make a portable fridge with a volume of 50 liters, which should be sufficient to store a bottle of water, excess milk, chocolates, etc. Come, make with me. A fridge basically needs a cooling element. Our traditional refrigerators have a long list of components such as the compressor, condenser, evaporator, etc. to push the heat out. But the fridge that we are going to build will not need any of these items. I'm going to show you how to build the fridge by merely using a Peltier module. This is the Peltier module. When a voltage is applied in these wires, one side of the Peltier module gets super hot and the other side gets super cold. Nearly 200 years ago, when Charles Peltier tried passing current between two conductors made of different materials, he found that the temperatures of the junctions to change. Actually, Charles Peltier wasn't the first one to observe this phenomena. Many have tried such experiments in the past. However, this Peltier module is based on Peltier's effect. Okay, let me break open the Peltier module to show you its construction. What you see at the bottom are electrical contacts, and the cubes on top of that are P and N semiconductor pellets. You can see the electrical connections on both the sides of the PN junctions. Industries use alloys consist of bismuth telluride with either bismuth selenide or antimony telluride for making these P and N pellets. Doping is used to segregate between P-type or N-type. Let's take a detailed look at how it works. The white sheets on the top and bottom are usually a ceramic substrate made up of aluminium oxide or beryllium oxide. These ceramic materials have high tolerance towards heat and cold, and they are also good insulators. Now let's take a look at what the internal elements do. To have the Peltier effect take place, we require two different types of materials. Let's take an N-type semiconductor, and for the second one, we need a different kind of conductor. For this explanation, let me use a copper conductor on both the sides and apply voltage. Now when I apply voltage, electrons start flowing through the wires to pass through the copper plate, then through the N-type semiconductor. So the electrons will still continue to flow through the N-type semiconductor to pass through the other copper conductor to finally discharge at the positive side. But something interesting happens here. When the electron jumps from the copper contact to the semiconductor, it will either lose or gain energy. When the electron travels up, it will absorb the heat at the lower junction and then deposit it at the next junction. Now let's take a look at a P-type semiconductor. For a P-type semiconductor, the majority charge carriers are holes, which are positively charged. Holes does the opposite. So obviously, the junction at the positive side becomes more chill and the next junction becomes hot. We can't create a high temperature gradient with just one pellet. Moreover, this single pellet will consume 5 to 6 amps of current for a voltage less than 100 millivolts. So this needs to be reconfigured in a different manner to make something useful. The subatomic physics behind this is very complex. Anyhow, for some basic understanding, let me try to explain this at a very high level. Now let's arrange the P and N-type materials in a specific manner. Here we got the P-type and N-type pellet. We need two dissimilar materials for the Peltier effect to take place. We got the semiconductor material. For the other material, let's place a copper contact on top of the semiconductors, connecting both the materials. Now let's make a different arrangement at the bottom by placing another two copper contacts for each of the semiconductor pellet. Let me connect both these to the positive and negative side of the battery. When we switch on the power supply, the electrons will travel from the negative side of the battery to the copper contact first. Like I mentioned earlier, the majority charge carriers in the N-type semiconductor are electrons. So electrons will get pushed above and they will pick up the heat from this junction, making it cold, and deposit the heat to the other side, making it hot. Now let's move to the P-type semiconductor side. Here we have got the majority charge carriers as holes, and this side of the copper plate is connected to the positive side. Since the holes are positively charged, it will pick up the heat from this side, making it cooler, and dump it on this side, making it hot. So now we have got a hot side and a cold side. The electrons will pass through the N-type pellet and copper plates to combine with the holes in the P-type semiconductor pellet to finally reach the positive side. Electrically it is in series, but thermally it is in parallel. This P-N pair is called a couple. Technically people call it as a thermocouple. We require multiple such thermocouples in the Peltier module in order to create a good amount of heat or cold. As we add more thermocouples, we need to arrange them electrically in series, like I have shown you on screen. The first three numbers on the Peltier module represents the number of thermocouples present inside it. So there are 127 thermocouples in this particular module. This module is called a thermoelectric cooler in the industry. In order to get the best results, we have to use a heat sink and a fan on the hot side to push the heat out of the module. Similarly, we will use another fan on the cold side to circulate the cool air within the fridge. I have decided to extend the functionality of our fridge a little and transform this into an IoT-enabled smart fridge. Let's take a look at the fridge construction in our next video. Thank you for watching this video. See you again.